Credence to President Muhammadu Buhari. Order foreign diplomats formally welcome to assume official duties in Nigeria include the Ambassador of the Republic of Gambia, Famara Kasigai, Ambassador of the Socialist Republic of Sri Lanka, Thambiraja Ravinthiran, and the Ambassador of the Islamic Republic of Iran, Murtaza Rahimi Zaki. President Muhammadu Buhari, who received their letters of credence separately, formally welcomed the envoys to Nigeria and hoped to see improved bilateral ties with their respective countries in the coming years. At an audience with the Indian High Commissioner to Nigeria, President Buhari said Nigeria will strengthen cooperation with the Asian country in education, transfer of technology, and military training. The relationship between Nigeria and India, which he said predates the nation's independence, cut across various critical sectors of the economy. President Buhari said, as of today, India is the biggest buyer of Nigeria's crude oil, and more of such beneficial partnership is needed as the country tries to be more innovative in education, manufacturing, and agriculture to diversify the economy. Ambassador Reddy said the Indian government is looking forward to consolidating its relations with the ministries of petroleum, agriculture, trade and investment, as well as power, works and housing for the execution of projects critical to the nation's development. He said the Indian Chamber of Commerce has already established a Nigerian chapter with a view to promoting trade, especially in the energy sector. It will be recalled that President Muhammadu Buhari attended the Defense Services Staff College, Wellington, India, between 1970 to 1973, and the Asian country also played a significant role in the establishment of the Nigerian Defense Academy. From the State House, Adamu Sambu, NTA News.
And turning to the economy, the Minister of Finance, Kemi Adeosun, has stated that the fundamentals needed to support the diversification of the economy is infrastructure, for which 75 billion naira have been released in the last 2 months. She stated this while briefing the Senate on monetary policy adopted by the federal government to salvage the current economic situation in the country. National Assembly correspondent Grace Onyenube reports.
Said a strategic fiscal sustainability plan is in place to resuscitate the economy.
We said that agriculture was going to be our main focus. We said that we would ensure that we became self-sufficient in food. The food price inflation we've seen was that last year we had not paid our fertilizer bill from 2014. So there was no fertilizer for 2015. And I want to also make an appeal that there are certain areas where we need the National Assembly's support. There's 58 billion in UBEC, which most states cannot access. And we don't want them to continue borrowing. We believe that given the circumstances of the Nigerian economy, it wouldn't be wrong for us to consider an amendment that would reduce the counterpart maybe to 10% for a short period of time. The procurement law at the moment is a key, has been an inhibitor to our progress.
Questions on all sectors of the economy were asked by the lawmakers.
So I'm happy that you are now saying that, as the Minister of Finance, that the constituency projects, not just of the Senate, but of the National Assembly, will be taken seriously because they will impact directly on the lives of Nigerians. So, Honourable Minister, please walk the talk.
The masses that voted us are waiting. And they are most interested in two items in the budget, the job creation and the poverty alleviation program.
There is hunger in the land. The 27 states can no longer pay salaries.
For the first time, for the social intervention programs, we released 15 billion of capital and we put in 5 billion this month for recurrent. Various agencies being coordinated under the office of the Vice President to implement those various social intervention programs. 27 states can currently not pay salaries is laid at the feet of the current administration. The previous administration were borrowing to pay salaries.
She also explained that a new comprehensive waiver policy is expected in 4 weeks and that Nigerians' propensity to import can be quelled by economic patriotism. The Senate President had earlier read a correspondence from President Muhammadu Buhari on the confirmation of 47 career ambassadors designate. The Committee on Foreign Affairs now has a nod to screen them after an earlier uproar over the list sent. Also, for the first time, a collective budget proposals of 38 agencies were sent to the Senate and was referred to relevant committees. These agencies will come to defend their budgets. President Buhari also sent a request for the confirmation of the chairman and seven board members of the Niger Delta Development Commission, NDDC. The chairman nominee is Senator Victor Ndoma Egba, former leader of the 7th Assembly. The Senate president reshuffled some committees. Senator Kabiru Marafa is now the chairman of Petroleum Downstream, while Senators Hope Uzodinma and Adamu Aliru head Customs and Aviation respectively. The Senate has adjourned till the 18th of September for its annual vacation. From the National Assembly, Grace Oyenubi, NTA News.
In an effort to improve the healthcare delivery system in the state, the Rivers State government has promised to give private medical practitioners loans without interest to upgrade their facilities. The governor made the promise during an interactive session with medical practitioners in the state. Ogedi Nyekwere completes the story.
The interactive session was aimed at discussing issues hampering quality healthcare delivery in the state. Governor Wike said a seven-man committee will be constituted to oversee the disbursement of the loan, which members of Nigerian Medical Association will be part of it. The initiative, which he said is in line with his electionary promises in the health sector, said quality health care delivery is important to the present administration. On the issue of multiple taxation raised by the medical practitioners, the governor expressed displeasure at the attitude of some revenue agencies, noting that government is not aware of some of their activities. Chairman Nigerian Medical Association River State Chapter Dr. Furo Green and Chairman Private Medical Practitioners Dr. Henry Sota appealed for assistance and enabling environment for private health practitioners.
If you would kindly direct us to sit down with the revenue agencies and they look at what is actually legitimate for us. Sometimes we pay particular tax to state government, we pay to
local government,
we also pay to sanitation
authority. We need basic equipment, no doubt about that. But the long and short of it is that we do not have financial support.
The doctors pledged support to the administration and promised to be more dedicated to their duties. In Port Harcourt, Ogedi Nyekwere, NTA News.
With heightened preparations for the rerun of the remaining elections in Rivers State, attention is equally shifting to the Independent National Electoral Commission, the security agencies and the electorate on the need to play by the rules in order to lay to rest issues arising from the 2015 general elections. Kingsley Amajiri examines the preparations by INEC in ensuring a credible and conclusive elections.
Election materials arrived Ward 9 Unit 7 at about 9:45 in the morning. Accreditation and voting went on peacefully. At about noon, Governor Wike and his wife Suze arrived at the polling unit to exercise their civic rights. The governor was pleased with the security presence at the center but expressed dissatisfaction with INEC as delays were still experienced with the card readers in the accreditation of voters.
Most people would have boycotted this election or would have stopped this election today because people are saying that there are fake result sheets. And I tried to call the INEC commissioner to ascertain the authenticity. Well, you can see from his discussion that obviously there are some problems, and these are problems that could lead.
We do sincerely apologize for the mix-up in that film report. We'll now bring you the story on the reverse rerun preparations in River State.
As the rescheduled River State rerun elections draw closer, there are increasing concerns from stakeholders to allow the will of the people prevail in order to lay to rest the prolonged struggle arising from the 2015 general elections. Of concern to some stakeholders is the perceived consequences a mad electoral process would have on the socio-political fabric of Rivers State, given the protracted effect similar elections have weighed on the socio-political system in recent years. Given that elections come and go every 4 years, concerned stakeholders harped on the importance of a transparent electoral process, even as they stressed the need for sacrifice towards restoring peace and development in the state.
The Rivers State had no representation at the National Assembly. It is regrettable. And so people like me are prepared to make the necessary sacrifice to ensure that the forthcoming election is free and fair. We will cooperate fully with Independent National Electoral Commission to ensure that no disruptions, so that whoever wins should go and represent the people.
I think the people of Rivers State have suffered serious disadvantage in terms of representation because of the issues of election. The politicians in Rivers State should see it as such. If there are elections, come and play within the rules of the umpires. Now, after the elections, if you lose, accept it in good faith and wait for another turn.
As July 30th date draw closer, observers noted that key to achieving a successful and acceptable electoral process lies with the unbiased disposition of INEC, the security agencies, and the cooperation of the electorate. In Port Harcourt, Kingsley Amajiri, NTA News.
And to shed light on the preparations by INEC to ensure a heat-free elections come July 30, 2016, we have here in the studio Mr. Godfrey Achibie. He is Head Voter Education and Publicity, INEC Rivers State. Sir, thanks for joining us on Panorama.
Okay, thank you, sir.
All right, sir, now look at how important this election is to INEC in Rivers State.
The rerun election of July 30th, 2016 is very important because it's the conclusion of all the elections that started right from even 2015. So we are concluding the election come this Saturday, coming Saturday, or upper Saturday, 30th July 2016. It's important in that we want our people of River State to have their full representations, both at the national legislature and the state assembly.
All right, so how prepared are you in terms of manpower and other technicalities?
We are prepared because we have gotten the ad hoc staff that we need for the election. We are having our ad hoc staff, we are recruiting. We have already recruited the ad hoc personnel from the federal agencies that are in the state, federal institutions, and the NYSC, National Youth Service Corps. So we are getting personnel from this area, including some of our staff from the South-South Zone, our state offices in the South-South Zone. They are sending us ad hoc staff, INEC personnel, that will complement the one we have here in the state.
Okay, one would have simply assumed that considering the number of INEC staff that we have across the country wouldn't have been out of place if INEC could deploy others, staff from other states across the country to have enough hands capable of running the elections.
We are restricted to the South-South states to complement those of the federal agencies and the NYSC. We are not getting from other states apart from the South-South zone.
Okay, let me take you back a little and let's look at some of those issues that were raised, you know, that led to the inconclusive elections. What were those issues?
The issue there mainly is violence, the electoral violence, not allowing the system to run smoothly, disrupting the smooth running of the system. For example, not allowing our people to go out from the racks to the polling unit, or where they've gone out of the racks, some of them were hijacked on the road, the materials were hijacked, they were, you know, harassed. So these are the issues that disrupted the last election, electoral violence. which have been appealing to the politicians to rein in their people, their supporters, allow the process to run smoothly. We are going to have smooth elections if the process be allowed to run smoothly.
So do you have that synergy between INEC and the politicians?
Yes, we've been meeting with them since after the last election, the last rerun election. We have been having stakeholders meetings with the political leaders, the candidate, and the electorate, both at the state level and at the AGS. We are even having a sort of peace meetings with the political parties, the 28 of them that are in this state. We have been meeting with them. We signed a peace accord with them that this time they are agreed that they are going to ensure that this coming rerun election will be hit-free, violent-free.
Okay. So you are the head voter education INEC River State. How well have you done in terms of ensuring that electorate know what is expected of them?
Yes. We'll be talking to them on the radios, having our programs on the radios, and we have our offices at the AGS. They have been talking, holding stakeholder meetings where the electorate are invited, the political leaders in the AGS are invited, so that they spread the information down to the grassroots. So we are using all these processes to reach out to our people.
Okay. Now, security challenges contributed to a large extent to the issues we had in the last elections. Now, how are you working towards ensuring that there is that synergy required to ensure a hit-free elections come July 30?
Yes. We have been meeting with the Interagency Consultative Committee on Election Security. We have it in the state. We have it in the AGS. In the state is headed by the Commissioner for Police. We have all the military, all the paramilitary, they're all members. So we've been meeting and they've been assuring us of adequate security during this election. So we've been meeting, at the state level. Our officers at the AGA level are equally meeting with their own interagencies, committees of the election security at that level. So there have been that assurance that this time we are not going to have much problem again, security-wise.
All right, sir, let's take your final appeal to the people of River State, all that are concerned in this election.
Yes, our appeal is for them, most especially the political leaders, the candidate, and their supporters. Please, we want this election to be the final, as far as the legislative at the state, at the national level is concerned. Let this election be the final. And we are appealing to you, please allow the process to run smoothly. And we are going to have free and fair election. So that is my appeal to them. Please, the electorate, let them come out and vote. Everybody's vote must count this time. So everybody should come out, feel free, come out and vote. Politicians, their agents, their supporters, please let us have smooth and free elections.
Amos, thank you very much, Mr. Chibie, Head Voter Education, INEC River State, for finding time to be with us on the program today.
Okay, thank you, sister.
Now, while the River State government is intensifying efforts at addressing rising insecurity concerns with demolition of perceived criminal hideouts, there are also worries by some residents of the affected areas of the implication of a poorly managed housing and social crisis that may set in. Kingsley and Marjorie, in this report, takes a look at the government's new initiative and the concern of residents.
The activities of kidnappers, cultists, armed robbers and assassins heightened at a point in River State, threatening the peace which the state was once renowned for. But the state government, in its efforts to stem the tide, took a radical measure by demolishing perceived criminal hideouts, including waterfronts, noting that intelligence reports indicate that most of the criminals use the waterfronts as hideouts.
We're not going to end until they stop, until we know that criminals are no longer here.
But in as much as they still believe that they will operate in this state, we'll continue to do what we're doing. And we're going to stop at nothing to make sure that we eliminate criminality in this state and to give people, investors, the hope to be back in Port Harcourt, because this has been a very good place for people. We don't see why people will come to this state to harass innocent citizens.
However, for the residents of these affected waterfronts, the 7 days ultimatum issued by the state government ordering them to vacate the area is not enough, resulting in a street protest in which the affected appealed to the state government for more time and all compensation to enable them resettle.
You keep me the quick, 7 days. He'll be hard for 7 days. Please let him give you some time. And if you want quick off from that, let him give you something to take back out and get another other place. I'm begging him.
I didn't have anywhere that I will carry my children and my family to. I am pleading with the government and the whole people. They are suffering. If the government wants us to quick out from waterfront, let the government settle us.
Why these agitations lingered, concerned citizens and stakeholders are worried about the implication and or housing and socioeconomic crisis that will set in if the government goes ahead with its plans without any remediative measures to address the peculiar needs of these people. In Port Harcourt, Kingsley Amajiri, NTA News.
That's the size of our package on Panorama today. We thank you very much for being a part of it. Do have a great day.